Joining us is our resident film critic, Michael Snyder. These are the films he's going to be talking to us about. Risk, new documentary. Burden, a new documentary. King Arthur, the legend. Snatched. The Wall. Paris Can Wait. Farewell. Farewell to Europe.
Stefan Zweig, Farewell to Europe. Oh, my God. Sometimes I wonder about you. You're a smart man, I thought. Come on, buddy. Stefan Zweig. We all know him.
I'm not as smart as you. Tell me about the Julian Assange. Is this Laura Poitras?
It is. Risk is, it seems almost like a follow-up to her incredibly good documentary, the You Are There documentary about Edward Snowden, Citizen Four, that basically is her shooting right in the middle of the big Snowden crisis, where he has to basically run for his life and find shelter, I guess, in Moscow eventually. Now she's done the same thing, maybe even simultaneously, with WikiLeaks editor-in-chief and bête noire, Julian Assange. And the documentary is entitled Risk, and she interviews the guy. And where it was easy for me to root for Edward Snowden, you know, the hacker leaker, for some reason, I'm like on this guy's side as I'm watching him and his travails through her camera eye. Not so easy to get behind Assange, who, politically speaking, seems like a rogue more than anything else, more like someone who wants to shake things up rather than actually do good. I know that sounds like, you know, me editorializing, but hey, whatever. But what happens is you see her following him around and interviewing him while he is reaching prominence, you know, 7, 8, 9, 10 years ago. And then when things start going awry, and he too, like Snowden, goes on the run. But as I root for Snowden, it's difficult to root for Assange. And that kind of changed the way that this film, Risk, struck me as opposed to Citizen Four. I mean, it was fascinating to be on the inside of Assange's story, but the guy is kind of a douche. I mean, he's not, he fancies himself, you know, V for Vendetta, the, you know, the fictionalized thing about a revolution in modern day England led by that roguish character V in the mask that was adopted by the Occupy groups. You know, this guy thinks he's V, but he's not. He doesn't have the nobility of the true spiritual revolutionary. And the movie itself seems to lack a consistent point of view, like as if Poitras is as ambivalent about Assange as I am watching it.
What is your ambivalence? What is your ambivalence about Julian Assange?
Go ahead.
There is the accusation of rape. Do they discuss that?
Oh, yes, and they deal with it quite directly, and that does tend to color things a little bit. One of these masters of the universe type, self-styled, who thinks he can get away with anything, becomes a sort of subtextual narrative as you're watching Risk.
Is he guilty? Do you think he's guilty of this?
Who knows? I wasn't there. You know, that's the thing that you have to consider. You know, hearsay, he said, she said, she said. I guess there were two women involved. Mm-hmm. Anyway, it can be considered as a point of view. Are you on his side or not? But the absence of one from Poitras, who is, you know, seemingly looks upon him in an adversarial way in some ways, whereas she felt a certain kinship with Edward Snowden, one would presume. So that doesn't make for as compelling filmmaking as I would have hoped. But still, fascinating to be at close quarters with this guy.
I think he's very interesting, and I don't know, I guess, the rape accusations, but he hasn't been found guilty yet, right?
No, I don't think so. I think that it's that some of the charges have been dropped, but you have a situation here where you see this guy who seems like he is raging against the machine, and on that you want to, like, root for him. But on the other hand, he seems like, you know, a screw-you kind of guy, too, who doesn't care who he tramples. You know, so there's a question of humanity here, you know, and it's unfair to...
Humanity or purity?
Well, I would say, you know, I sometimes question how humane the guy is when he doesn't seem to care who's left in his wake when he does what his self-styled, you know, morality pushes him to do.
Are there people left in his wake? I do know that he works with newspapers and they redact certain things.
There may be some. I think there have been people who have been victimized by this who maybe don't deserve to be. But, you know, I would generally talk more about how the man strikes me as I watch this by comparison to how Edward Snowden struck me. You know, maybe it's a question of demeanor. Maybe they are equitable. But I thought that Citizen 4 was a better film. You felt that you really had a kind of a rooting interest in this guy, whereas this guy you're just sort of fascinated by.
I will say this about Julian Assange. We live in a nation where Tribune is about to be bought by the right-wing Sinclair television group. Television, radio, and now newspapers are owned by basically five corporations. We don't have the money. Media does not have the money to do investigative journalism anymore.
They're stifling it.
They're stifling it. So he has filled the gap left by the greed of corporate America. You need Julian Assange and WikiLeaks because big media will not spend the money to do investigative journalism. That being said, we have Mattathias Schwartz on the show today. He's a national security reporter for The Intercept, Glenn Greenwald's website, which I recommend everybody go to. Glenn Greenwald worked with Snowden and works with WikiLeaks. We need investigative journalism, and somehow they say the money isn't there, so we need WikiLeaks.
Well, you know what? Huzzah for that and that reason alone. He himself is very, very secretive because I guess he perceives of himself as a target, even as he is like trying to unearth the truth, ostensibly, or some of the misdeeds of those in power. You know, speak lies to power? No, you know, truth to power, whatever you want to call it. And you're right. It is a necessity. We need more revealed about what's been going on in terms of potential treason in our own country on the part of people who are in charge for whatever reason. That said, if you look at this as a piece of filmmaking, I do believe that this feels incomplete and less conclusive than mm-hmm. the Snowden movie. We learn a little bit about the people around the
Assange,
for sure.
Yeah, but she got lucky.
Yes. In terms of Snowden,
yeah,
in both cases.
She was there when it all broke, and she was there with Glenn Greenwald, who was meeting with Snowden.
To be fair, she's also with Assange a lot of the time when, like, crazy, you know, sort of volcanic circumstances are occurring in his life and in his, shall we say, his struggle.
Isn't he basically in the Ecuadorian embassy in London?
For much of this film, he is. You know, I don't know where he is today. Tough to say.
Burden.
Chris Burden is an interesting case. He is now departed, this mortal coil, but in the early 70s, he became one of the most innovative performance artists and installation artists to come down the pike. This is the man who made art of being shot by a colleague with a gun at his own behest. And he's also the man who had himself crucified on a Volkswagen, on a VW bug. He electrocuted himself. This is a guy who, okay, you ready? He locked himself up in a locker for 5 days. I mean, he did all these things starting when he was in school, you know, mm-hmm. and as a would-be artist. And eventually, I don't know. Actually, let me amend this. I do know that you live very nearby one of his most beautiful and memorable installations. You used to, at least, live near LACMA. And the L.A. County Museum of Art has something called Urban Lights outside it, which is a whole series of vintage street lamps that are in rows.
That's him?
Row upon row. He oversaw that installation. And it's so beautiful and memorable. It's the sort of thing when people say, what do I go see when I'm in Los Angeles? Well, I'm thinking, sure, maybe you want to see a giant mastodon model stuck in the La Brea tar pits, but walk a few other blocks and you'll come upon Chris Burden's Urban Lights, and it's gorgeous at twilight.
Yeah.
So this is a guy who had a fascinating career, and after all of this craziness, You know, and again, that's the Los Angeles County Museum of Art. Open, I don't have the actual figures, but after all this craziness, he retreated to the hills, essentially, and began doing his work there and kind of lay low for a while. But he was incredibly innovative, and this movie, Burden, doesn't tell the whole story, but it has a lot of archival footage from back when he was first starting, and has some interviews with him before he died a few years ago. So if you're interested in... you know, cutting-edge art and artists, and one of the most unique sculptors, performance artists, installation people to ever come down the pike. This movie about Chris Burden, which incidentally is directed and co-written by Richard Dewey and a guy named Timothy Marriman, it's pretty cool. Worth checking out.
Better than Elevated Rock. Did I remember that? That they took
Elevated
a
rock?
At LACMA, at the L.A. County Museum of Art.
Oh, yeah.
They
yeah.
spent millions of dollars to bring a rock up from the Southland. And people were rightfully infuriated by that. Some guy said, this is art. And they paid millions to just hang a rock outside the L.A. County Museum of Art. And you wonder why people want to defund the arts.
That might have been Chris Burton. I know that he dug a giant hole in the ground at LACMA. He was one of the people who did part of that excavation. Look, you know, you win some, you lose some. Urban Lights, beautiful.
And he got shot?
He wanted to do a performance on film of someone shooting him. And the guy was supposed to shoot him and, you know, just miss him or something. I don't know, and actually hit him in the arm. And there you go. The idea was to graze him, but he got it full in the meat of the arm. Hmm. And it was stunning, and you can see a lot of it on film. If that alone brings you to the Chris Burden documentary, well, already.
And he sang in The Animals, right?
That's Eric Burden, no relation.
I know.
What is it, The House of the Rising Dumb? Get it?
King Arthur Legend.
No, it's King Arthur Legend of the Sword. Ah. Now, how's this for a misbegotten idea? Guy Ritchie, best known for his gangster movies, set in modern-day England, particularly Lock, Stock, and Two Smoking Barrels, and secondarily known for being foolish enough to have married Madonna for a while and allowing her to scuttle his career by forcing him to make a remake of the great Italian film Swept Away starring her instead of, a talented actress. Guy Ritchie kind of found his métier more recently in the wake of that kind of bump in the road career-wise by making the Sherlock Holmes films that starred Robert Downey Jr. and Jude Law. So well and good. He's sort of bringing a kind of Batman sensibility to the Victorian set Sherlock movies, which are kind of charming and Bond-esque in their tongue-in-cheek approach. So now, emboldened, he decides to take on the Arthurian legend, but it's told, even though it's set back in, ancient times, if you will, it's told British gangster style with Art and his boys up against his vicious uncle who's on the throne. And Art's played by Charlie Hunnam from, among other things, Breaking Bad. What's the one about the motorcyclists? His mass cycle, Katie Sagal. I've never watched. The name will come to me, but that's irrelevant. The
Sons of Anarchy?
Sons of Anarchy. He was also in the Guillermo del Toro movie Pacific Rim about the giant robots. He's a good actor, and he'll do most anything. What, giant robots, motorcycles, and young, hunky king-to-be Arthur. And Jude Law, who was so good as Watson in those kind of wacky Sherlock films, is here as his vicious uncle who has, allowed people to die on his watch just so he can consolidate his power. So what you have is swords, a stone, there's a lady of the lake, there are mages and peasants and sword fights, but Arthur's gang are like gunslingers without gaps, if you will. No guns, just swords and knives. I guess, a guy in the East End of London will stick you with a shiv, and so would one of the soon-to-be King Arthur's not-so-knights. And there's a lot of modern cadence and slang. It just is flat. You know, it's big, it's noisy, it's crazy. It seemed like a waste of my time. I mean, I really love Lock, Stock, and Two Smoking Barrels, and I don't think I've enjoyed a single Ritchie film as much as that one. And there was a, you know, a number of people, including Ritchie, contributed to the script. And admittedly, you know, it's hard to hate a movie that has, among other people, Chiman Hunsu, Aidan Gillen, Eric Bana has a small role in this thing, but it just did not work for me.
Yeah, this looks fun. Snatched, that has Amy Schumer and Goldie Hawn. The trailers look fun.
Yeah, well, wrong. Nice to see Goldie Hawn back on the big screen, and she has aged well, I dare say. And her husband, holy crap, he's wonderful in Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2, Kurt Russell. And Goldie, both on the big screen this weekend in various theaters, and their son Wyatt Russell, who is sort of Owen Wilson, the next generation, and a good and charming performer too. He's showing up in various films, but this is not what I hoped it would be. She still has the great comic timing, but here she plays Amy Schumer's overly protective mom as the two end up stuck on a vacation trip to, I believe, Ecuador, that goes horribly wrong, as in kidnap for ransom wrong. You see, no one wants to go with the obnoxious Amy Schumer character on this getaway to South America, so rather than piss away the ticket, she offers it to her housebound mom to get mom out of the house. Mom lost the husband ages ago. She's been caught up in being a homebody. So Amy's character thinks this is going to be a tonic. And anyway, the mom, of course, turns out to be more than a match for the Latin American gang members who target the women. And there are violent moments, and Amy Schumer leaves blood and gore in her wake, either willingly or inadvertently in this movie. And it's just not funny. Violent, some tired setups, and unfunny, and you're sweating the whole time as they're wandering through the Latin American jungle. Joan Cusack has a few good moments as the sweetheart of Wanda Sykes' character. They're involved on the periphery of this. Ike Barinholtz is insufferable as the obnoxious brother to Amy Schumer and the son to Goldie Hawn. Christopher Maloney has a brief run here. You can't fault some of these cast members, but man, not a good film. I really, Goldie Hawn deserves so much more.
That's too bad.
And who
was the comedic mind behind? Did Amy write the movie?
I don't think she had much of a hand in it, if she did at all. The truth is, it was written by a woman named Katie DiPolo, who I don't think DePold or DePoyed, a name I wasn't familiar with, directed by Jonathan Levine. Let's finger the guy. I just don't think the script is very good. Some people, they can nail the comedy. And in this case, these two women tried their very, very best. And again, I'm not a big fan of Amy Schumer's. I wasn't.
Sacrilege. Take that back.
TV show, her stand-up. Look, you're a stand-up comedian as well as a commentator and radio host, and stand-up is a different thing. Sketch comedy is a different thing, and acting and holding down a lead role, all different. And I will say that her, well-received starring vehicle from a year or so ago is a considerably better film than this one. And, she has yet to impress me, except as a sketch comedian and writing her own material. She has impressed me, but,
How about all the lives she saves by appearing in a bikini?
Well, I will say this. I am among those people who don't find her attractive.
Well, what I'm saying is the body acceptance that she's forcing on American women to accept their own bodies. That's pretty important stuff.
I don't mind a zoftic woman, frankly.
Nor do I.
I don't at all. But I just want to tell you, I don't find her particularly attractive. She's not my type. Although she's very smart and she has good comic timing, but the material she's been choosing film-wise has not impressed me anywhere near her skits on her own television program.
Yeah. There are other things at play besides what you see. I noticed this. There's a friend of mine who does a year of The Godfather at the Cellar, and it's hysterical. he brings comedians up and they reenact The Godfather word for word, one of the funniest things I've ever seen. And a comedian or a comic named Rachel Feinstein played Kay Corleone, the Diane Keaton part.
Yeah, the wife of the Al Pacino character, Michael.
She added a whole other angle to it, which was what an idiot Kay was. It was a very feminist interpretation. I found it very nourishing and enriching, and I've seen The Godfather like 1,000 times, so it was nice to see people interpreting these parts comedically. But I don't see Kay Corleone as an idiot. Once Rachel started playing her, I thought, oh yeah, what a horrible role for Diane Keaton.
I see her as someone who just acquiesces. I've always thought that the character is sort of tragic and pathetic and desperate because she acquiesces and doesn't fight back. But it's the times and the nature, I think, that, of that life and that lifestyle and that milieu. You know,
the point I'm making is that we watch Snatched one way, and I would assume other people see it a different way.
Funny is funny is funny, David Feldman, and this is not very funny. And again, let me praise the talented Goldie Hawn and acknowledge Amy Schumer's earlier work as a sketch comedian. This movie's just not good.
It's a big studio film. It's a big studio film.
I'm not going to point fingers at the, well, I just did, you know, the writer and the director.
Okay.
But, you know, it didn't do it for me.
I was taken to see Going in Style, and I didn't feel like I was taken. I really didn't want to see it, but the person who wanted to go, I acquiesced, and I didn't think it would be fun. I don't remember anything about it other than it was light, it was fun, and it ended. Did you see Going in Style?
Yeah, I thought it was a sort of a half-assed, let's make something familiar that we know so we can finance it, otherwise we can't finance a film, and let's get guys that we can rely on in the characters, and I just thought it was just, you know, business as usual from Hollywood and not a great film. The original movie in its era was kind of entertaining, but I didn't think the original was that great either. I did like the performers involved, I just wasn't impressed. But, you know, we go to these things to get diverted. We don't necessarily go there to be enlightened at the movies.
Well, I never go to a movie for diversion. I just don't. I only see serious documentaries or great comedies, which are diversions. But for the most part, the idea of going to see Going in Style, again, they're remaking it. I agree with you. I didn't see it the first time, but it was fun. The Wall with Doug Liman. Do you know who Doug Liman's father was?
Lemon Lyman, the guy who invented that delicious soda flavor?
No, he was the attorney during the Contragate hearings.
Well, la di da,
and he let Reagan slide. Go ahead. What is The Wall?
Okay, it's a very tight, very taut, very tense. Yeah, I just kind of repeated myself, and very exciting. And the latest from director Doug Liman. And those of you who don't know who Liman is, he's the guy who directed Swingers, Jon Favreau's kind of coming out party, along with a variety of his jive-ass pals, including Vince Vaughn. And then moved on to direct, among other things, the best of the Bourne movies with Matt Damon. Now, this is a guy who takes a simple premise and two actors, one, by the way, quite good, and makes a relevant but timeless thriller about a soldier under the worst kind of pressure. He's pinned down in the middle of the Iraqi desert war zone by a Haji sniper who has him in the crosshairs and manages to be able to taunt him by walkie-talkie. A British actor, Aaron Taylor Johnson, is unrecognizable as the USGI, but totally plausible. This is the guy who played the young John Lennon in Nowhere Boy, a wonderful kind of docudrama biopic about the teenage years of John Lennon as he's just getting to know Paul McCartney. Aaron Taylor Johnson also was the star and title character in Kick-Ass, which is a wonderful takeoff on superhero movies. Speaking of which, he was in Age of Ultron as Quicksilver, one of the Marvel heroes, and so on. he's fantastic in this. And then there's John Cena, who just has to be his hunky fellow soldier in the movie and does a fine job of considering the limited needs of the role. And, you know, you're basically, it's a gripping film for an hour and a half or so as this two-person firefight, you know, with a corollary soldier involved, that being the John Cena character, going down. And, you know, you're hoping for all variety of resolutions. And, you know, it doesn't play easily. You know, it's kind of a tormented, it's a tormenting of the viewer, but it does so very expertly. I really thought The Wall was good. It's the best film we've talked about so far.
Oh, great. Okay. Alex Bennett, who we have to have on the show. I was talking to Jackie the Joke Man Martling from the Howard Stern show, and he was reminding me how Howard freely admitted to being influenced by the great Alex Bennett. When I was on the show about 20 years ago, he had Eleanor Coppola on to promote her documentary about the making of Apocalypse Now. I believe it was called Heart of Darkness. Great documentary. Yeah, remember that?
First-rate documentary, and she, of course, had the inside tracks, and she was married to the director, Francis Ford Coppola.
I would assume they're still married.
So, I don't know. I don't know if they are or not. I haven't checked the society pages, David.
Halfway through the Alex Bennett show, I turned to Eleanor Coppola, and I said, could you give your husband a message? And she said, yes. And I said, can you tell Francis that The Godfather does not hold up after the 3,000th viewing? And she just looked at me stone-faced. And I went, it's a joke. It's a joke. I've seen The Godfather 3,000 times. So it's a joke. Saying it doesn't hold up after you've seen it 3,000 times. Not...
Yeah, nothing? Nothing?
Got nothing from her.
Not even a slight dry grin?
No.
Just a glass. Wow, holy crap. Well, guess what? Her film, written and directed by Eleanor Coppola, Paris Can Wait, doesn't really hold up for one viewing. How's that grab you? And I'm not joking. This stars Diane Lane and Alec Baldwin as a sort of well-to-do couple. But yeah, you had me at Diane Lane, and you had me at Alec Baldwin. They are the wife of a very driven movie producer, and they're in Cannes, but the husband is so busy, he asks his French friend and compadre to drive the Diane Lane character
So they're driving back to Paris, and there's sexual tension between Alec Baldwin's friend and Diane Lane.
Damn, it's like I'm talking to Cassandra, because, an ugly thing happens at the end. Yeah, you're talking tragedy. I have to say that, you know, you can't complain about Arnaud Viard, who plays Jacques, the buddy. He's great. If Diane Lane, you know, she's top drawer. You love looking at that face. She's so good at what she does. Alec Baldwin, what's the old, you could read from the phone book and you'd be entertained. But this movie it's like the height of meh. Right, you do get the French countryside, and you get the dream of, oh, I wish I was taking this drive with people I care about instead of these two people. Not enough Alec Baldwin. I felt a little bit, you know, like, Alec, phone this baby in, you know. Eleanor said, I just need you for a day or two, and I will fly you to Cannes and then fly you to Paris. What do you say? Hard to say no about that. And again, this is the woman who wrote the wonderful, directed the Apocalypse Now documentary. Like you said, Hearts of Darkness. She does not have a way with comedy, I don't think. This is, you know, it's not bad. It just seems like a vanity project. You know, she was able to put this together. They had a ball making it. It just is not a great film.
But it must look great.
It looks okay, because you kind of wish you were on the trip.
But the cinematography has to be. Amazing.
It looks good. I enjoyed watching it because I'm traveling, you know, through the south of France, something I love to do on the rare occasions I get a chance to do so. And, man, thank the fates that yours truly has had a number of occasions to, you know, travel through the south of France, one of my favorite places in the world. Can't complain in that regard, but this is not a very good film. It does not, as a romantic comedy, it also kind of makes some missteps in terms of plot and dialogue, and you're kind of rolling your eyes at it. I just wish it had been better.
Farewell to Europe. I won't say the first name. Stefan
Zweig, Farewell to Europe. This is a movie I saw a little while ago that was presented by the Goethe Institute in Los Angeles, which is, the German culture, the German culture club, if you will. They're located in many big cities, particularly, to my mind, in L.A. and in San Francisco. And they present films and film series. And I got an early look at this film, which is just now getting a theatrical release in the States. And it's all about a guy I didn't know anything about, a incredibly popular and well-read German language writer of the mid-20th century, Stefan Zweig, who was, in fact, a Jewish intellectual and was in Germany as the Nazis were coming to power and got out, despite knowing that he had to do something and say something about what was going on in his home country. And this is a man who longed to be in his home country, but couldn't for obvious reasons. So a large part of this film is set pre-war and during the war in Buenos Aires and New York and Brazil, where he's traveling and living while all of this tumult is going down in Germany and the surrounding countries in the late 30s and early 40s. So he has to kind of express himself as best as he can and, you know, rail about the situation from a distance. And at the same time, he's trying to find a place where he can feel comfortable in this side of the world. So Maria Schrader, who is a pretty solid actress, co-authored this and directed it. And Joseph Hader is fantastic as Stefan Zweig, and a familiar face as his wife, Frederica, Barbara Sukawa, who's been in a boatload of films, including, I think, some Fassbender films. It's a pretty solid German cast, and they did a great job. And this is somebody I didn't know anything about. It's a little dry, perhaps, for some people, but, you know, I thought, very well done. And again, you know, it's rare. You talked about going to documentaries to learn stuff. And, you know, you don't necessarily want a trip to the movie theater to be, you know, like going to school. But I got schooled by this film, you know, and I learned a little bit about an historical figure that was, somebody I had no knowledge of prior to seeing the film.
What are you watching on Netflix?
I am watching The Handmaid's Tale, or as I have subtitled it, Pence's Paradise. I don't know what you
Isn't
know about
that
The
Hulu?
Handmaid's
Tale. I thought that was Hulu.
And no, it doesn't matter. You want to talk about streaming? There's Netflix, there's Amazon, there's Hulu. They're all out there doing their thing. The Handmaid's Tale has been fantastic, an adaptation of Margaret Atwood's chilling futurist novel about an oppressive theocracy, a.k.a. a twisted version of America that seems all too familiar with every day, where women are just birthing chattel and have no rights and are just there for procreation. And some women decide that they ain't too happy about that, which is why I subtitled the show Pence's Paradise. You know, you get it. Theocracy, yeah. Mike Pence. Mm-hmm. Anyway, that is one wonderful piece of work. Believe me, I'm very, very excited about that. I've been loving on FXX the latest iteration of Archer, the animated TV series about a tough guy, spy / private eye. And in this one, he's having this particular set of episodes. He's in a coma and he imagines himself a Raymond Chandler-esque private eye in Los Angeles, and it's a period thing set right after World War II, and he's got PTSD, and it's funny, and it's just sharp and well done. there. John Benjamin as the lead voice, and Aisha Tyler as the girlfriend, and Jessica Walter as the overbearing mother, and it's top drawer stuff. Judy Greer is in the voice cast. I love Archer. I'm very entertained by it. And, you know, there are other shows that are coming down the pike soon, among them the return of Orphan Black on BBC America. There's a lot of stuff out there. You know, you just have to know where to find it. Are you watching anything on Netflix right now?
I'm excited this Sunday. King Charles III will be on Masterpiece Theater.
Ah, I don't, I've not seen that.
It's the play, the Broadway. I think it won a Tony, I'm not sure. Hey, and finally, the Giants.
Yes.
The Giants, how are the Giants doing?
The Giants are not doing well, and they're breaking my heart right and left. And the San Francisco Giants baseball team, which of course began as the New York Giants baseball team, are like lifeblood for me day in and day out. I, you know, have no great stake in it. I don't cover sports per se. So it's
my name is David. My name is David, not per se. Why do people keep calling me per se?
Per se Bichet Shelley? That's a poet joke. Anyway, so listen, seriously, Madison Bumgarner, the greatest postseason pitcher arguably in major league history, and that's over a century, hurts himself on a dirt bike, the Giants ace, about 3 weeks ago. He's out for 2 months. Suddenly their chances of the playoffs don't look as good as they did before, and their hitting has been subpar. The other pitchers have not come through. Their middle relief has been weak, and this is all while Buster Posey, perhaps the greatest player in all of baseball, is hitting the horsehide off the ball. He's been hitting 365, something outrageous in terms of his batting average, yet there's nobody on base for him to drive in. So they have been struggling. And believe me, when the Giants struggle, so do I. Thank goodness my Golden State Warriors of the National Basketball Association look like they're going headlong toward a confrontation with their arch rivals, the Cleveland Cavaliers, in another NBA final coming up in a few weeks. I'm hoping the Warriors plow through. Even though I spend so much time in Los Angeles and love it dearly, my heart, sports-wise, belongs to the 49ers, the Warriors, and the Giants up in the Bay Area.
And how are you living without Vin Scully?
Well, you know, Dave, the young man from New Orleans, Louisiana. Here's what I like to say. Vin Scully, a national treasure. Too bad he was affixed to the hateful Los Angeles Dodgers all those years.
Is anybody left from that generation, or was he the last?
Of that particular ilk?
Yeah.
Probably that old smoothie is probably the last one. I'm rather thrilled that he originally grew up as a New York Giants fan, and he ended up becoming identified with the Los Angeles Dodgers, formerly the Brooklyn Dodgers. And they just, about a week ago, they put some kind of plaque up at Dodger Stadium at a game where the Giants played the Dodgers, and the Giants pulled the game out. And I was laughing. I'm driving down the 10, listening to the game, and I'm like, take that, Vin Scully. Take that, Dodger fans. You know, I'm not saying I hold a grudge. I'm just not, you know, one to give up on my home team.
Michael Snyder is our resident film critic. We'll talk to you next week.
Well, as soon as we can, my friend.
Great.